save the explanation. So here we're explaining just the architecture of the Auger project and how you start examining it. And there are a few significant directories to be aware of. The first one is Auger. Auger contains two things. First, it contains all of the Auger server processes. My computer seems to be not, oh, there we go. Save it for there right now. So that's in the, I'll call it the, oops, Zogger slash directory. And so in there, in the Auger directory, you have application.py. This is the main Auger process. Essentially, it's what gets compiled into Auger, the executable. Then also of significance, you have config.py. This generates the auger.config.json file that is used to tell Auger what workers to run when it starts. And it contains a template for that JSON file. So if I open up config.py, you can see that it when you install Auger, you are provided with a set of questions. And one of them is, how are you going to connect to a database? Are you going to connect to an existing Auger schema, connect to an existing database and create the Auger schema, or connect to a server and create both the Auger database and the Auger schema? After that, it will prompt you for the database name that you want to use and the host name that you want to use. Your key is your GitHub API key. These are password, default Postgres port, username, and then you provide a GitLab API key. Those are the first three things that you're prompted for. And from there, it's going to generate this file. The housekeeper file tells Auger what models to run. Models are tied to workers in this way. I'm just going to pause for a second. Because I'm just pausing because it might be helpful to I already set up my Cintiq. All right, I don't know why it's showing me that. Go away. Sorry, I turned on another monitor. Okay. All right. The layout's not exactly what I want it to be, but so be it. All right. I just have to remember that. So Oh, I see what happened. Sorry about that. Yeah. All right. Okay. So where's my Zoom? So, like I was explaining, before technology so rudely interrupted me, is the way the config file and the housekeeper works. So you'll, if I take you back to, I thought I paused sharing, but did it?
Yeah, you're not sharing.
Yeah, I paused sharing. I guess I meant to. All right, so I'll have to edit that out, but because nobody needs to look at that. But essentially, with Augur, you have you've got a housekeeper. So you have pause the recording because so I'm resuming the recording. So, Auger, can you see the whiteboard okay? So, Auger has a number of parts to it that manage it, but when it comes to the workers take two specifications from the auger.config.json file that's generated when you install Augur. And I recommend for your work that you install. Can you read that okay? Or is there too much
Yeah,
glare?
yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's
No,
okay.
it's fine.
Okay. Since our config.json has two blocks that you want to be or you would be concerned about, one is housekeeper and the other is workers. The housekeeper tells you which models to run for which repository groups or repo IDs, depending how you want to do it. Most of the time, these settings are set to zero because you don't need to you don't need to share anything advanced sharing options. That's not it. All right, share. Advanced. Right, so I'm gonna do this a little bit different. So much technology, so little time. So if we get even more up close and personal here. I can share that, and I should be able to also you see that screen. I want to share the auger.config.json at the same time. So now you can see the auger.config.json, but only my original screen, right?
Okay.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead.
On the board, you wrote auger.config.json.
Right.
This is config.py, not.
So config.py generates that when you install Augur. And it has several important blocks, but two of them relate to the workers. The one is the housekeeper. These are the models of data to collect. So for example, if I want to, did I lose the cat? So for example, if I come back over to this housekeeper block, I look at underneath it, it has jobs. And contributor breadth is one of the jobs, issues is one of the jobs, merge requests. So here we have for GitLab merge request commits, and merge request files. So in the example of the GitLab worker, so just for an example, the GitLab PR worker. It has three models in the housekeeper. And these three models that are in the housekeeper, merge requests, merge request commits, and merge request files. If we scroll down to the workers directory, here's your GitLab merge request workers. And this is your, so this is your housekeeper block for GitLab workers. There are three models. Down in workers, you have one worker. And so the housekeeper is specifying what data are you going to collect when you run that worker. And the reason you might tweak these is if you have 5,000 repositories you want to collect data on, you may want to begin small. So for example, you might want to just get all the merge requests. And then, so you would turn on the merge requests model and then go back later and rerun it with files and commits to get that data. So if you just wanted an overview of the merge requests to start, that's something that you might do. The worker block over, which is what I'm highlighting over in the config.py that gets generated, it's going to give you a port. This is a default port that's open on most machines. You can specify the number of workers, and the switch is whether or not it's turned on. So by default, we don't turn on every switch. We turn on a subset of the switches. And then as you decide what data you want to collect, you turn more of them on or some of them off. And there are some workers that you don't want to run simultaneously. And there are other workers that you're well advised to run sort of in a certain sequence. And we're working on a change to the housekeeper to let you specify that sequence. So this is the file that gets generated when you install Augur for the first time. And those are the two main blocks. The other blocks that you'll run into that are important are the, you got this, just makes sense?
Oh yeah, it does.
Dhruv, is this new for you? You make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, like kind of yeah, or yeah, like just go ahead and move on.
Like this is definitely a little new for me. You did introduce to me in the last hackathon, mm-hmm. but you know, every time when you explain it feels new.
Yeah, Yeah. And so at the bottom of your configuration, and it doesn't really specify it. I guess it sort of does. So at the bottom of your configuration, the other things that are important are come back here, bring that push this back a little bit, get a little bit better look at things. Can you still see the whiteboard okay?
Yeah.
It looks like I've got some glare coming from behind me. Let me just pause the recording for just a second. Record any of that. Oh, well. What I just explained was that in your augur.config.json, you have a housekeeper and a worker directory. The housekeeper directory specifies which models in a particular worker are going to be run. So for example, use the GitLab pull request worker as an example. And there are three models: merge requests, merge request files, and merge request commits in that worker. And the housekeeper is where you can specify, I only want to just collect the merge requests for now. I'll go get the files and commits later. So you would essentially not collect that model. You would set that model's value up in the housekeeper block to some repo group ID that did not exist. So you could set it to repo ID 1, and then it would only collect for repo ID 1, which won't exist in any Augur database. And then for workers, so if I'm running the GitLab pull request worker, then workers are in the worker block of the housekeeper, which we did explain in the video. They're down here. And here is your merge request worker. And if I flip the switch for the merge request worker to on, then that worker will run. If it's a 0 off in the binary expression of the world, then it's flipped off. Augur does have the capacity to run many workers at the same time. Logic, you can use your own sensibilities for which workers that makes sense for and which workers it doesn't. Anything calling an API, logically you could run more than one worker and it would collect more data. Anything not hitting an API, it's likely not to make anything go faster. Because, like, for example, the machine learning workers generate, cost a lot of CPU and memory, so you may not want to run more than one of those at once. And then in your server block, as we were discussing, you want to change your front end host to me.host.eu so that you can run on Nginx. That's the Nginx sites enabled. Augur front end dist is generated with npm run build. And that's in your main Augur directory. The config.py gunicorn.py is simply the thing that starts the workers. Super easy. Server.py is a part of the application.py in that it's actually the thing that starts the server. So application.py and server.py work together. Logging.py is just a generalized logging class. Housekeeper.py is what manages all of the broker activity. So when you get into housekeeper.py, so you've got your housekeeper and your workers. Your housekeeper is what tells, basically, the housekeeper reads the models and sends it to the worker. So the way that you can think of it is that you've got your server and then you've got your housekeeper, and the housekeeper is what sends jobs to the broker. puts a broker in here. And that is what passes jobs out to the workers. So the broker is useful and the housekeeper is useful. When you're running more than one worker, it's going to pass those, it's going to pass those jobs out to multiple different workers in a relatively even-handed way so that you get the most optimization out of that. That is the auger directory of auger. We don't have to go through all of these, by the way. The next most significant directory is front end. Front end is where you actually build the front end for auger. We talked a little bit about that. The source is here. And we are using a Vue.js and kind of front end. And the next one that's good to look at is tests. If you're going to be developing on,
I have a question. Can I ask?
Of course.
So in front end, that package files. What are those package files?
These are the dependencies for Augur. So there are view client serve, view client build, view client service lint, test, view client service, test.lint. These are the scripts that run, and then the dependencies that need to be installed at their particular versions. And then if you're doing development, these are the development dependencies that need to be installed.
Okay.
And then package lock.json is a file that locks them all in detail. So when you run npm install, npm install is going to look at this. And then package lock.json is going to create a lock file that locks down the version on your local machine. So we seldom will commit either of these files because we like to have some stability in the front end, and the package lock.json file can change depending on the npm version that you're running locally on your machine.
Okay, yeah.
The biggest thing to remember about Augur is it's got a Flask-based, Python-driven front backend and API. However, it has a front end that's based on npm, and we're slowly moving to a Twitter Bootstrap version of the front end that we think will be far more dynamic. And we're also excited about the auger-community-reports directory or repository in the Chaos project that has a lot of really good information about it, about Chaos. And it lets you explore your own questions, if that makes sense, much more readily than without it.
Okay.
Schema is pretty straightforward. These are the schema generation scripts. We've maintained a list of each schema change we make. So if you installed Augur 6 months ago, there's a table in the Augur operations schema called Augur settings, and schema version is one of the values. And we're going to check the schema version and do all the updates since you updated your version of Augur automatically. You should do make rebuild or make rebuild dash dev. Scripts are simple utility scripts used for installation and configuration that call other programs. Tests are what they say they are. Util is largely related to Docker. And then some of the meat of Augur is in these workers that we have. And so this is where we might spend a reasonable amount of time if you want to understand what the workers are and what they're doing and how they work. Do you want to learn more about the workers? Like, I can give you kind of an overview.
Yes, please. I don't know if Dwarf wants to learn about it, but...
Dhruv, are you curious about this stuff, or are you...
Yeah, especially the GitLab issue worker, I was also kind of wanted to solve that issue on GitLab.
Yeah, so let's take a look at these workers one by one. And let me start by pointing out that every single worker has, in order to not repeat functionality that exists that's required for any worker that calls an API. We have this worker base file that's been developed and evolved. It's a fairly large Python class, but what it does is it takes all of the general things about a worker and it makes the workers themselves these much smaller, more manageable Python files because it includes a set of methods. So if we look at just briefly what the parts of worker base are, you've got your worker class, organizing needed data, assigning tuple action, checking for duplicates, connecting to the broker, dumping your queue. You can find a person from login and get the owner of a repo, the max ID, the values, the initialize the authorizations that you have at your disposal. And then bulk insert. Bulk insert is basically during initial collection, this is a very important method, this bulk insert, because it lets us collect in memory a lot of the data for pull requests and issues and perform one large database operation. It enables much faster data collection. Text clean is a function that any worker can use. So if you're collecting message text, you know how special characters can cause problems. Text clean is a general method that does that for you. Enriching data for the primary keys is a generalized method for you specify in each worker what the primary keys are and also what the merge fields are. So the merge fields are ones that might indicate not duplicates. And then multi-thread URLs. This basically multi-threads any call that you make so that even if you specify one worker, it can multi-thread things out and collect more. Paginate endpoint is a good general function that replaces paginate. So if you have more than 100, by default, GitHub gives you 25 of the records in an API call. You can change that to 100. Reducing your number of API calls. And then GitHub will also tell you, and GitLab will also tell you how many pages you have, how many 100 record pages you have. And paginate endpoint essentially makes sure that you get all of the data. And then query GitHub contributors is to say, okay, if I have a pull request that is from a contributor that isn't already in my database, I will then query those contributors. I also have a bulk method for that. And I have the same method for GitLab. This makes a record of the model process. So there's a history table, a worker history table in the auger operation schema that this makes a record in. Registering task completion tells the broker and makes a log message. Registering task failure tells the broker and makes a log message. Getting relevant columns is how you identify which columns you want to update when there's an update. So for example, a pull request status or open or close status may change over time. Updating the rate limit for GitHub and GitLab are general methods. And then there's a general update rate limit. And so worker.base is a large file, but it contains all of these useful functions that any worker is going to need to call. Making sense so far?
Yeah, you're making sense.
All right. So, and so the next thing is let's to look at the workers. And when I look at the workers, what I might do is, I don't know if I can do this. I'm trying to think of a visual way real quick for me to show you the workers. All right, I'm going to share. Oops. All right, don't maximize. I don't like what it does with that. So if I've got these workers, right? Let's talk about each of the workers and what they do. The first is, let me do layout.
I think so, you're not sharing.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much. A classic error that I make. I appreciate having pointed out so that I don't go too far. All right. Am I sharing the screen that says Augur Workers on it right now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So let's start with the data collection workers. Just at a very high level, you have contributor breadth worker. And I don't like the spacing here at all. Let me just try. Single line spacing, let's see. Okay. So I have the contributor breadth worker. I have the facade worker, the GitHub worker, which focuses on issues. I have the GitLab issues worker. The Linux badge worker, the pull request worker, release worker, repo info worker, and the value worker. Actually, I put value here. So then I have these data collection workers. These workers go out and actually get all of the data. Can you still read that? Okay. Is that big enough text for you?
It's fine.
Okay. So then I'm gonna, there's some different kinds of workers that come up. And I'll just so then after the data collection workers, you have your, what I'll call them is analysis workers. These workers do things with the data that you've already gathered. All right, so it's just going to be different workers. So it's going to be different. That's going to be fine. So, do I seriously have to format this every time? No. All right, so analysis workers. All right. I don't know why it's not really bugs me. All right, see if that worked. It didn't. All right, there we go. That's looking more promising. Nope. All right, whatever. All right, so you have your workers that do analysis. So your contributor worker does basically reconciles multiple identities. Your also over here, GitLab merge request worker is one. As well. Just gonna reduce that indent later, I guess. So your contributor worker, that's a machine learning worker. And your value worker. So the contributor worker and the value worker just do straight up analysis on the data. So the contributor worker resolves multiple identities into a single identity, and the value worker applies. So this is the identity resolution for contributors. And this value worker is the one that uses Kokomo complexity for each file in a repository. So the value worker has a lot of utility from that perspective. And then bring this back down to be aligned here. Machine learning workers are the clustering worker. The discourse analysis worker. The insight worker. Apparently spelled discourse wrong. The message insights worker. The pull request analysis worker. Worker. I feel like I'm missing one. I might not be. Yep, there's five. Okay. So I got them all. I have no idea why that's all right. All right. These should all be no. All right. Well, it's imperfect for now. But let me stop and ask. I'm going to explain the workers to you and how they do what they do. But in each category, the data collection, but not have okay, bold, the analysis and the machine learning. They all do different things. So data collection is important because these are the workers that go out and get your data. The analysis workers are important because things like knowing the complexity and the lines of code is super important. And machine learning worker really lends itself to these various insights that I showed you earlier that are in this slide deck. So do you have a preference on what kind of workers you'd like to start with? Or if you want to try working on a worker and seeing how it works, what's your preference as we start here?
Well, as for me, considering my background in machine learning, I'll probably start with either the analysis workers or the machine learning workers.
Okay. What about you, Dhruv?
Yeah, it's fine for me, and I would like also want to go through. I like you said as working on workers. So
okay, why don't we start with looking at the clustering work? Why don't we just start by looking at these machine learning workers? I think the most interesting ones are the message insight worker, the discourse analysis worker, and the clustering worker, and I think they work together in some interesting ways. And what I think we should do, we've been together for an hour and 45 minutes now. I think we should take like a 10 or 15 minute break so we can grab a cup of coffee and go do things we need to do and come back. It is 42 past the hour here. Do you want to come back at the hour or at 5 until the hour? And then we'll dig into workers.
That looks fine.
For the workers, we were going to look at some of the machine learning workers and how they work, as it were. So what I might do is I think Adam lets me open. All right, so I think Adam lets me make its screen bigger. Let me see if that works. Maybe it doesn't. Maybe it's all the same. Uh, No, I guess it doesn't offer me any greater ability to make it bigger. So we'll just, I don't think, oh yeah, I can at least make the file contents bigger if I can't make the sidebar bigger. So these are the machine learning workers, and let's just start with the clustering worker, unless you want to start somewhere else.
No, it's fine. Let's start from the clustering worker.
Okay. So the clustering worker, all the workers, with the exception of the message analysis worker, which breaks some of the functionality out into multiple Python files that are called from the main file, have a runtime.py. That runtime tells you what things need to be imported at runtime. So it usually includes your actual worker and then any other libraries that are required. And you can see workers util has some create server, worker Grunicorn app things that are imported, and that's runtime. So when you run a worker, this is very common. It'll say app.worker is the clustering worker. This is going to map to a class in the clustering worker.py. And then all of this is going to look very much the same across each of them. And then the setup.py file essentially imports the things that you need to compile the runtime worker. And it will list the name of the worker, its version, the URL, the license, the author, their email, worker to cluster repository based on messages and pull requests. It says that the install requires these libraries. This is the entry point. It's typically the worker runtime main. And there are some classifiers indicating the programming language. And then of course init.py doesn't do anything in this case. So this is the clustering worker. And to start just looking at the clustering worker, it might be helpful to go to our readthedocs.io documentation, which I'll expand out here, make it a little bit bigger. And start a Docker right here. These are the make commands. There is some worker documentation. Maybe it's only in dev. I know each of the workers has some docs, and I'm pretty sure they were built, but maybe. Docker. All right. I'm a little bit puzzled about why that's not in there. So let me just run back up to the docs section. Just development guide. Could be that workers. Okay. Workers/TOC is not included. So let me include that. And then I can go to a command line. This is my Jupyter Hub command line. I just want to show you there's some docs for many of these workers, especially the machine learning ones. Make docs view. Okay. So show in a proper directory. I'm not in I didn't start a virtual environment. All right, so merge request worker, GitLab issues worker. Let's go back to the workers. Clustering, okay. So the TOC, GitLab merge request worker. So this should actually be, I just copy another TOC. We have clustering worker, discourse analysis worker, insight worker, message insights worker, and pull request analysis worker. I'll refactor the rest of that on another day and time. All right, so now if I go to workers, I should be able to look at the clustering worker. So basically what it does is it looks at the comments and issues and pull requests and clusters the repositories based on the content of those messages. The worker also performs topic modeling using latent dirge delay analysis. So clustering is this. The vocabulary is using a TF-IDF vectorization of data. It does a k-means repo messages, which is a trained clustering model. The features does vocabulary counting and does a trained Leighton-Dirge-related model for topic modeling. And then prediction is made on the documents, et cetera. This is the configuration, which is what goes in the auger.config.json. Clustering workers requires like max DF, the set of threshold, which filters out terms that have higher document frequency, corpus specific stop words, filters out uncommon words. Max features is the maximum number of features to be used in calculating the matrix, and clusters defines the number of clusters. So that's what that worker is doing. And if we look at, then if we go back and we look at the clustering worker. So docs here for the moment. So you can see a couple of things. One is that it's importing a number of things that one uses in machine learning, including scikit-learn, Seaborn is a mid-visualization, NLTK, NLTK stem snowball, sklearn cluster, and then pickle. And so these are the libraries that it imports. And every worker has a class in it, like the clustering worker. And the first thing it states is the worker type. This worker type actually takes us back to, if we go back up to Augur, the config worker. Clustering is the model. So somewhere in here, it's going to declare a model, models, clustering. So that model is what goes in the housekeeper block. And the given of a git URL is also specified at the top of the worker. The worker type, clustering worker, is relevant down here in the worker block because it's called clustering worker. And so that's the way that you can kind of understand that these three things that appear at the top of each worker are what the housekeeper is looking for when it is starting the worker. Each worker, thanks to our worker base architecture, simply has to state what tables are having data put into it. There's repo cluster messages, repo topic, and topic words. And that those are the three tables that get populated. Oops, wait a minute. Yep, okay. So this is just stuff that gets specified. It sets any parameters that it needs to set for the libraries that it runs. and it defines the number of topics and the words per topic. And it downloads an NLTK library called NLTK Punct. That's downloaded. You're giving an option to download the NLTK dictionaries that are needed by the machine learning workers during installation. So the first piece that exists is the clustering model. It trains the model, gets the matrix, does the clustering and labeling, visualize the labels, does a count, pre-process and tokenize, and that's kind of it. That is what the clustering worker does. So when it comes to training the worker or training the model, the first thing it does, it selects data from messages. And there are two places where the messages come from. Repo, pull requests, auger data dot message, and auger data pull request message ref. And then issues, auger data message, auger data issue message ref. And the message df all just simply reads that SQL with whatever parameters are passed into it, which aren't any right now. It's just simply all of the repos. So this can pull the messages itself and actually train the model. And so it's going to train the model by, you know, grouping by repo ID, where it's picking a link to filter by where there are at least 500 messages. And if there aren't 500 messages, it says there's really not enough to cluster on. And it combines the repository to form a single doc, does an index reset, and then it does a TF-IDF matrix with the features that are specified here. You can do a visualize labels function is commented out right now, but it could work. And then it does the LDA, the topic modeling, where it, again, uses a tokenizer. It does a fit on each message text, counts the matrix, and does a pickle dump of the vocabulary, counts the features, and then tries to fit the model and the topics. And so topic ID equals one for topic and topic list. So you can see however many components are in this topic model. It does, it iterates through them, records the topic ID and the word, which is the feature names, essentially, for whatever feature names are in that topic model, and then inserts the record. And it says primary key inserted a topic words table, insert topic list in the database, save the model, and predict on each repo separately. And then, it does this, and then essentially does a clustering model on each repo and logs it. And then get the TF-IDF matrix is simply vectorizing the matrix. Giving it an n-gram range, transforming it into a text list, and then dumping it as a vocabulary, and then returning the TF-IDF get feature names. this is a k-means model to determine the number of clusters, the pickle dump, which is the messages, and it returns that. That's used by other functions. This visualize function, which I don't think is enabled right now, will create plots and label the plots. And then the count function gets the count for the words and the tags, and it can pre-process. This is the pre-processing and tokenizing. So so you can see, if you sort of look at this as a pattern, it's doing some things that are fairly common in the use of these machine learning algorithms and making predictions. And I'm trying to find the self.dbexecute topic words table. So I just go back to the top here. Sometimes search is easier. This obviously isn't used. This puts it into the repo cluster messages table. And this puts it into the repo topic table. And this puts things into the topic words table. So then those tables are so for example, here are the repo topics. So there's up to 5 different topics that are identified here. And the topic words table, fascinatingly, I'm finding consistently, I don't know if it's that it's not calculating, but it's consistently not populated. So let's just take a second and look into that. I like to make my terminals a little bigger so people can read them when I'm using this giant screen. All right, so see GitHub. So this tells us when this finished. And it looks like the clustering worker, let's see what it may be that let's try this here. If I do htop, sometimes the clustering worker can take a while. Let's see. because obviously what it's doing, this is an old machine. Okay, so the clustering worker is still clustering and taking up a non-trivial amount of the CPU to do that clustering. And the topic words are still empty. So if we go back to our topic words, LDA model components. I am going to just say here that LDA model.components underscore maybe a syntactic feature of that library. I don't know if either of you know. The fact that the topic words aren't being populated. Oh, there we go. Topic list equals LDA model.components underscore. But I am somewhat fascinated by why it's not populating topic words. Can either of you see why it might not be populating topic words? All right, so far it's not hitting that. So what I'm doing now, I'm doing a git checkout dev clustering -b dev clustering. And so now I am on a new branch and I have saved my old branch over here. I committed the work, the documentation updates that we did to dev. And I don't know, do you want to look into this together? I'm a little curious. Are you curious? Debugging a worker, is that useful to you?
It is.
So what I might encourage you to do is do a git push. I just pushed a dev clustering branch to the Augur repository. You may have to refork it to get that branch, or you might be able to do a pull request from that branch into another branch that you're working on, like dev. It should merge pretty easily because it's only got two new things in it right now. Do you want me to show you how to do that? Have you both cloned Augur or forked it?
Please show me how to do that.
Sure. So the easiest way to successfully, my computer stopped responding a little bit. So what I recommend is going to the Augur. Have you forked it already, Stephen?
Oh, yeah, I forked Augur already.
Okay, perfect. So we'll do this. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my fork of Augur, which hasn't been updated in a while, and I'm going to do a pull request. And the pull request I want to do is not back into Augur, but from my fork, and that's going to say, yes, compare across forks. It's a little bit weird how it does this. If you change the fork over here, it sort of messes stuff up. So what I want to do is I don't have the dev clustering branch on my server. So I just want to merge it into dev. But I want to do it from Chaos Augur's dev directory. Let me know when you're there. Oops. GitHub is really finicky. Oops. And my fingers are not on the correct parts of the keyboard also. So when I type dev, it just keeps giving me a bunch of junk. So what this is doing is it's moving the current version of dev into xGoggins. Oh, and I actually wanted to do dev clustering. and I just create the pull request. Have you gotten that far?
I'm trying to look at this from here.
Do you want me to, did I go through that too fast? Should I back up?
Okay, yeah, you can back up.
All right, sorry about that. So first things first, you go to your fork. Are you in your fork?
Yeah, I'm over there now.
Okay, do you want to share your screen? Maybe that would be, I could walk you through it that way.
Okay, that would be perfect. Okay, so here's my fork. You can see my screen, right?
I can, yep. So this is your fork and you're on the dev branch. So you want to click the pull requests next to code at the top. You want to click pull requests and then you want to do new pull request. And here's where, let's try to do this differently. No, don't do that yet. Let's try to do this differently than I did myself. Let's change the repository chaos auger base from dev to dev clustering. No, that's good. That's good. No, don't do that yet. I think I found a way. Try to dev dash clustering. I'm trying to figure out like how to make this not be so stupid when you, because it ought to, okay, so now change Steven, the one on the left, the Steve Cola slash auger, change that to chaos slash auger.
Okay.
Didn't do it. Now hit compare across forks. And then change the base repository over on the left to your repository, which is, right there. And then change, and then try to choose, let's see if this works. On the right, the far right where it says compare, do dev clustering there as well. In the past, I've had trouble getting it to bring a new branch over, but maybe I was doing it wrong or being impatient. All right, choose different, okay. So this is not letting you do that, probably because dev clustering does not exist on your fork yet. So change the base on your fork to just dev. All right, now it lets you create the pull request. So now create the pull request with the big green button.
Okay.
You just hit create pull request. All right, and you can see there's some files changed, but if you scroll down, it's going to tell you if it can merge it automatically. It looks like it can, because usually there's a big message at the top. This tells you just all the things that, scroll all the way to the bottom. Scroll all the way to the bottom. And then you click merge pull request.
I understand that. I have a question right there. You know, the merging into chaos dev clustering, I actually didn't know that is possible. You know, I think I can only merge into a repository that I'm in maintainer or
so you what of. You're doing is you're merging from chaos dev clustering into your fork. If you go back to the top,
I can see that now.
This is a very confusing part of GitHub, in my opinion, because it's like reading from left to right. The repository that you are merging in, like you're getting stuff done, is being merged into the repository on the left. most human flow diagrams move from left to right, but pull request merging on GitHub and GitLab move from right to left. And this takes a little while to get used to because it is not intuitive to ordinary human beings. So now you've successfully merged that branch. Have you installed Augur on your computer locally?
Yeah, I did that.
Okay, so now let's go to the terminal where you made your installation. And I guess activate your virtual environment. If you've been through the install part yet? And I don't know if you know this, but if you hit tab. Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
And then you have to name the virtual environment, whatever it is, the first couple characters tab, and then bin/activate, right? I do this all the time. If you could hit tab and okay. Okay. Now you're in good shape. Now you just changed your Augur directory.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. By the presence of an augur.config.json, I can see that you have done an installation already. So have you built the installation? Obviously you have. So now the command that you want to type is make, and I'll put it in chat here. It's make space rebuild-dev. Since you're a software contributor, you want some of the libraries I put it in chat. The space was like a computer space. Like make and then spacebar rebuild-dev. I want to click on your screen. It's like this happens to me all the time in Zoom. I think your screen is my screen. And I try to click on it.
Okay,
so what this is doing is it's rebuilding everything based on the new things that have come to be since you pulled. And really the most significant things are I fixed an issue with one of the database updates that you've likely already run and had no problems with because I was recreating an index that already existed and that caused the Docker image to fail. And then the other thing that you're getting is an early version of the contributor Brecht worker, which we won't go into depth today because I don't want to widely promote it, but effectively what it does is it allows you to understand what projects the people who are part of your project. Okay. What version of what? Control C here.
Oh, okay.
Because it says you're not at Python greater than 3.6, yeah. So do a Control C, because this isn't going to work under a lower version of Python. Like stop the build with Control C if you can. All right. Do Python space -- version. Python spacebar. Okay.
It's my save.
That error that I saw makes no sense to me. Can you scroll up to that error? I've never, Streamlit requires Blinker, which is not installed. Scroll up to tell me what is, scroll up so I can see what's being built here. This is just the basic, so scroll down. So we see that error.
It should look better this way.
Yeah, just scroll down so we can see that error again. I want to make a note of it. I've not seen that before, but it's okay. So Streamlit requires Blinker. And Protobuf. greater than 3.6.0. And IPDB requires TOML. Greater than or equal to 10.2, and TOML greater than or equal to 10.2. All right, that's interesting. Okay, so yeah, go ahead and do make rebuild dash dev again. Sorry about that. I hadn't seen those errors in my own environment previously, and so I was
I don't know. Here's a suggestion. What if I just installed the dependencies that are not installed? I mean, this Blinker, the protobuf, two ML.
So for now, I'm just gonna check real quick here. Stop sharing your screen and I'll share mine again.
Oh, okay.
And I'll show you what I'm checking, and then we can go back to your screen. So I'm just going to go look at the setup.py in Augur. And IPTB and Beaker is what required Blinker and protobuf. So I'm just going to, for dev, I guess that should be like that anyway. I don't know. Beaker is up here, so I'm going to say Blinker. Give me a version. And protobuf and QML. Protobuf was also required. Protobuf greater.
It's just, okay. I think the protobuf is just one B, not a double B.
Just one F?
Yeah,
yes,
just,
you're right. Or
just one F, yeah.
Yes, you are correct. I TOML. And then IPTB requires TOML greater than or equal to 10.2. All right, so I'm gonna save this, and go ahead.
The 2ML is 0.10.2.
It's 7.10.2?
Yeah, 0.10.2.
0.10.2?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So now I've saved this.
There should be a comma after the 2ML.
Thank you. Common mistake. I make it all the time and then it doesn't work. So now all right, so all right, and I'm gonna do a make rebuild dash dev on my machine and see if adding those things messes anything up. And if you want, you could restart the I guess here's what I'll do. We'll do another pull request and I'll push these changes to dev.
All right.
Clustering if, in fact, it doesn't. It looks like it's going to work. Okay. It looks like there were some missing dependencies in our setup.py that I didn't catch, because honestly, when I go to make rebuild dev, I've done it so many times. I do it so many times every day that And I'll install the front end dependencies just because it's good to do that. But why don't I stop my share and then you can share and start your process. And I guess, well, I guess just wait just a minute. Maybe I shouldn't have stopped my share so quickly here. Hang on, let me share just one more time. Okay, and so it says my database is already up to date. So that works. Oops, so now I'm gonna do a get status and I'm gonna ignore the front end stuff. Do a git commit dash m libraries missing from setup.py added. Oh. Okay, what did I do? Oh, git add
git
setup.py. Yeah. Sorry. And I'm going to do a git push. So easiest way is probably for you to do another pull request, which will get these updates for your dev environment. I'll let you share your screen if we want to walk through that pull request process for updating from dev again. And we're updating from dev clustering.
All right. Yeah, it's from right to left, right? So
okay, yep. Now we have
mine should be at this side.
Yep, correct. Yeah, and then you have to, this is a really super annoying part of the GitHub interface. And you want to bring dev clustering
into my
over to dev. Your dev. If you wanted to have dev clustering, you would have to refork the repository. And then you but it doesn't matter because you can work in dev and do a pull request from dev. So it's not.
Yeah.
So then create pull request. And you have to click create pull request again, I guess. And it should give you the chance to merge. Okay, and now your setup.py is updated. And let's try make rebuild dev for you.
I was thinking if I don't have to do git pull origin.
Thing. No, you don't have, well, try, yeah, you do have to do git pull. Yes, you do. You're right. You're absolutely right. So do git pull because we did this. You don't even have to do origin. You can just git pull.
Okay.
You have to stash your package and package lock.json are likely to be updated, and so you can just git stash them.
Okay.
It's doubtful that you made intent. Git stash, not status. Common typo.
Git stash.
Stash, S-T-A-S, yes, exactly.
Okay.
All right, and then do git branch, git space branch. All right, so you need to do a git space bar checkout space dev. All right, now do your make space bar rebuild dash dev. Okay. All right, and let's watch what happens here. See if we see any of those persnickety errors. And while you do that,
Blinker is. Oh yeah.
All right. So I installed those things this time. While you do that, I'm just gonna share with the screen that I'm sharing. There's this omai.zsh shell that you can use that I find useful to make my shell because it tells me what branch of a GitHub repository I'm in as part of the command line. And just like Python lets you know the name of the virtual environment that you're running in, this omai.zsh gives you the information that you need to it shows you the branch in GitHub. So when you, I'll show you when we look at mine, but you'll see that it shows me the branch that I'm in. The left is the virtual environment, the right parenthetical statement in my shell is the GitHub branch that I'm on. So this is what a command line on my shell looks like. I just pasted it in chat with omai.zsh. And so it prevents me from forgetting what branch I'm in when I do something. That might not be as big of an issue for you, but you are in master, so you probably want to be working in dev at least. And this just takes a little bit of a minute to build depending on what kind of computing hardware you are gifted with.
Okay.
It looks pretty good. Some of the folks that we worked with in these hackathons have MacBook Airs. They are a bit trickier because there is, you know, they're running on i5 Intel CPUs and don't have RAM. You look like you have pretty good internet wherever you are. I don't know.
There's a little bit of one here. This doesn't matter, right?
There's a little bit of what?
Warning. I think I've been getting this message.
So that warning is that, so some of the workers have extra libraries that they install if necessary for doing development. Most of the time when we've already debugged it, we may take that out. Like if we think the worker is stable, we may take that out, but some of the workers retain additional libraries that when you do make rebuild-dev will get installed. And that message simply tells you that the message insights worker does not have additional libraries that it uses for dev work. That's all.
Okay.
Yeah. Downloading TensorFlow, that's going to take a minute. That's a half a gig. May I ask what part of the world you're in, Stephen?
Based in Nigeria, actually.
Oh, wow. I was going to guess Europe, but.
Sorry, what is, I didn't get that.
You what?
You said you are going to guess what?
I was going to guess Europe, like somewhere in Europe.
Oh, okay.
Just, but what part of Nigeria do you live in? One of the urban areas?
Well, I stay at Abeokuta. Abeokuta is like a town very close to Lagos.
Oh, what?
Most,
like a university?
I school in Abeokuta. The university is called Federal University of Agriculture of Abeokuta, but I do computer science over there.
Excellent.
Yeah, I'm a junior currently.
Oh, that's fantastic. Are you applying to Google Summer of Code?
Oh, yeah, I plan to, actually.
Yeah, well, it would be great to, if this was interesting to you, of course, it'd be wonderful to have you apply to Augur. We'll put up our micro tasks shortly. I've been doing a lot of Augur demos lately. This last week, this last week because I've had a lot of Augur demos and each one wants to see a slightly different part of Augur. And so putting together a demo is a bit of work because there's so much in Augur that people want to see. And it just takes a little time to put them together, like about a day. And then we did a release on Monday. So I spent all of Monday fixing, making everything consistent and finishing the testing for the release. And then Tuesday, I got ready for a demo that it was at 1 o'clock for most of the day. And then Wednesday, I got ready for a demo that was just an hour later that day. And Friday, I got ready for a demo that was Friday. So I'm getting very good at explaining Augur and building it. And so while you build this, let me take control of the screen back. You can let me know when you're done, since it's taking a little while to download. Did I lose you, Steven? Is your internet gone? I feel like Steven may have paused. I'm gonna pause the recording. Steven, maybe stop sharing your screen. I suspect that the screen sharing may be causing some issues for you. I suggest you stop sharing your screen and your video.
Oh,
because you froze for quite a bit, and so maybe we save your bandwidth for now. Okay, we lost Steven, at least briefly, and while we wait for his return, let me make sure I shared the right screen here. Sorry, I'm just gonna make sure. Sharing the right screen is such an art form in Zoom. Okay, so now what we've done is we made some updates to clustering, and where we were at is we were trying to figure out why the clustering worker is not executing the inserts of values not sharing the value inserts or not inserting values into the topic words table. So because we can see that topic words does in fact exist as a result. So what we're gonna do is we're not getting any of these log messages. And so we're just going to insert a log message here. And change this to just the format. Okay. And we're going to say topic list created. My suspicion is that the topic list is not getting created. And so the other possibility is that we get that far and something else goes wrong, but let's start with that. And we will go to have to make rebuild-dev, which it's a little bit faster on my machine than it is on a lot of people's because I have, well, my environment's already built. So unlike Steven, I did not have to download everything. I also have, I'm fortunate to have gigabit fiber to my house. Hey, Steven, welcome back. Are you continuing to build?
Yes, I was using too much of my computational power.
Or possibly bandwidth with sharing both your screen and your image. How many gigs of RAM are on your computer?
I'm using 8 gig of RAM.
8 gig, okay. One thing we might do is provide an option for people to not build the machine learning workers or all of them. But it looked to me like your computer was simply stuck downloading the NLTK library, which meant that probably me sharing my video is as big of a problem for you as you sharing your video. So why don't you try to, did your make rebuild dev stop or is it still going? Steven? I cannot hear you. You're not muted. Let's see if I can look in chat. See anything. I'm gonna assume you're still there. You look like you're there. I turned off your video and I'm sharing my screen. So what I did just to back you up, I'm wondering if topic list is getting created. And so I'm creating a log that's gonna format the topic list and see if it actually runs. And then I'm just gonna pause sharing of my screen here for a minute so I can look at my augur.config, augur.config.json without the parts at the top, All right, I'm going to resume my share. All right, I just didn't want the parts with all my keys to show up. Okay, and so now for my clustering worker, in this case, I'm just going to make sure my clustering worker is on, but I'm going to turn off all my other workers. I just really care about the clustering worker because that's what I'm debugging right now.
Okay.
And there's no need to... So you can see the switches are how I turn the switch to zero is how I turn things off.
Okay.
Metric status worker no longer actually exists. For a time we had tried to keep the chaos labels on our metrics, but chaos kept changing its website too often. It's probably stable enough now that we can re-implement that worker. But at the moment, or at the time, we just didn't, it became too cumbersome to keep track of that. So now what I've done is I've done a make rebuild dev, and the clustering worker is the only thing that is set to turn on. And I'll point out, in the Augur documentation, a space just before I get this off and started, collecting data. Running collections. And I'm just going to start. start. So under backend commands, you have Augur backend start, but a way to do it, and I guess I have to update the docs here, but this nohup Augur backend start and putting it to a log file is a great way of running Augur in the background so that you can also run the front end in the same terminal. And it also captures logs for you in a common place by worker. So I'm gonna run this here locally. And if I see to my logs directory, and let me make this a little bit bigger for you. I had it bigger earlier, but maybe that was a different terminal. So now I'm in my logs directory and I can do lsslhrt. There's not a workers directory yet, so it's taking a while to come up. Eventually it creates a workers directory in here once it's fully booted. I have a lot going on this computer, and it occurs to me that I may have had an instance. Okay, actually. Yeah, okay. I've actually sorry about that. I just I realized I had multiple I had an Augur instance running, and that's a problem when you start an Augur, another Augur instance. It'll generally go through the process of configuring. Sorry, that was my mistake, being a frequent Augur user. There we go. And if you're in the logs directory, eventually we create a directory called workers. Takes a little bit of a minute, I think, here.
Hello, Sean. So the process has finished installing the packages. So
okay.
I currently have a question. Would you like to install August front-end dependencies? That's the question. That's the prompt message I'm
putting. The NLTK dependencies? Or front end, yes. Install the front end dependencies. Yeah,
okay. Everything is done now.
I may have it says preparing housekeeper jobs. It seems like I have a, if I go back, there's a, when you're working with so many different versions of Augur, there's a new config block that this version apparently does not have. And it's in the housekeeper. And it's this update redirects, which actually is turned off by default and doesn't do anything. But I think, I think it might be complaining that that's not there. All right, let me try to make Augur again. Uh, I'll just go back and copy and paste. I need to update this so it's more obvious. Now I think it's going to give me my worker directory. Auger.log. All right. Yeah, that's correct. But this block that I showed you, you may need to add it. Have you run Auger before?
Okay.
Have you run Auger? You've got an auger.config.json. So you probably have to edit that auger.config.json to include this block from the and chats. Are you in our Slack channel, Stephen?
No, I'm not on the Slack channel. I wasn't even aware of the Slack channel.
Let me add you to our Slack channel so that I can send you something formatted well.
Okay.
Let me pause the recording for a minute so that you can share your email address without it. Oh, I meant sharing doesn't matter. It's recording that I want to pause. Hold on. I didn't resume. I just explained all that and I hadn't resumed recording. Well, that is one of those things. So I'm just really going to briefly point out that everything, every single worker relies on the worker base, and the worker base has a lot of methods that do deduplication, distinguish between records that need to be inserted because we don't have them or updated because we do. And in the GitHub worker, which collects GitHub issues, these two components given in models are what are referenced in the housekeeper. Worker type is referenced in the worker block of auger.config.json. We enumerate all of the tables that a particular worker is going to use. These operation tables tend to stay the same. And then for the issues model, we take the given and the URL, we access the URL. The action map includes a block for insert or update where both are possible. Specifies all of that, tells us what the merge fields are. So ID is the identifier for the GitHub API, and GH underscore issue ID is the identifier for a Auger issue. That helps us not include anything that's duplicated. And then for each component of a worker, we do these subtables. And as I was showing Stephen, we have issues has assignees, labels, a repo that it's assigned to. It also has events, and it also has messages. And so inside here, we get the messages and comments. We list the contributors needed to be inserted or updated. And then we do a bulk insert. And then we have the issue message ref table, where this is the bridge table between messages, where because we store all messages in the same place, and source comments, we get the ones that need to be inserted. You can see that the comment action map only includes insertion because there's never updating. And it's the same for issue events. And the action map is only inserting. And then for assignees, anytime for an issue or a comment, we first look to see if we already have that assignee in our database. And if we don't, we insert them in the assignee database under the contributors table. And then we update closed issues. We do the bulk assignee insertion, the bulk label insertion, and register the task is completed. The actual issue insertion makes a call to the method for contributor insertion during the course of of collecting data. So at just the issue level, we insert those contributors if we don't already have them as we go. So just as a brief review. Are there other things that you would like to show or try, Stephen?
Let me try and go to my list again. I have a quick question. For the Google Summer of Coda projects, only one of them is focused on machine learning. Only one of the chaos projects is focused on machine learning. Let me try and get the name again.
I believe that's an Augur project.
It's an Augur project. So advanced risk prediction with machine learning in Augur.
Go ahead.
I'm actually thinking of focusing on that. So I'm wondering in which worker would that be implemented?
Sure. Let's just go look at the chaos. I want to do chaos.community.
Governance.
That community, and then somewhere. Where's the Google Summer of Code link? Maybe under participate. All right, let me search.
Okay, I have the tab open here in my
browser. All right, why don't you send me a link?
So
shoot me a link in Zoom. Sorry. Our website isn't always the most easily navigable.
Okay. I've sent it.
So risk prediction with a machine learning worker. So for this, we have we would pool these existing computational models and identify projects that have similar characteristics. So it would be like building a model of models. And you could either develop, so there's two ways you could approach the project. One would be to advance the existing models so that they did more risk prediction kinds of things. Like you could just add to them. And also the mentors would include the risk working group. And so the risk working group is looking at a lot of things related to dependencies. So it could include like gathering data about dependencies and then looking at some of the metrics that we have sketched out with regards to dependencies. And there's some actually very cool ideas here right now. Let me just get you to meeting notes. And we have this dependencies resources spreadsheet where there's a number of needs and motivations, some things that we've identified as minimal viable products and some other resources. But the minimum viable products that we're looking at is like first just enumerating the dependencies for a project. And then if for any given project we've enumerated the dependencies, then we could use a collection of repositories that are in that dependency collection and run the machine learning workers over them, as well as just the regular chaos metric workers to discern risk. And dependency sustainability could really come from activity metrics, as well as our own Insight Worker, which I didn't show you today because it's been around for a while, and it just uses a k-means. It uses a random forest clustering algorithm.
Okay.
And you know, how many depines is a dependency referenced? Libyears is interesting. Known vulnerabilities would possibly, and so you wouldn't do all of these things, right? But essentially, okay. I think dependency sustainability risk can be discerned by looking at some of the language in the text. So there's so much work to do in this area that my suggestion to you is, if you have a particular part of machine learning that you're most interested in, that maybe you and I talk over Slack and try to tune what your proposal is, just so that it suits what you want to do, right? In a world where in a world where nothing's been built yet, like what you choose to build, it's not critical, right? Like we don't have a very narrow focus need on doing X in this space. There's a lot that needs to be built, and a lot that could be built with a new machine learning algorithm worker, a lot that could be built by taking the collection of insights derived from our existing workers and building a collected model. There's a lot that could be learned from building a brand new machine learning model. You could treat activity metrics the same way that the Insight Worker, which uses the random forest algorithm, treats activity metrics and look at those in a different way with a different model to try to predict the low risk or the high risk dependencies that a project may have. These are just a few ideas. So I would say there's so much work in this space that is possible that you can define for yourself what your proposal is.
Okay. Do you mind sending me the link to this?
Of course not. I'm going to send it to you in Slack because it's more permanent.
That would be
Zoom. And I'll also send you just our risk working group notes. We meet, it's a little late for you, but it's 2 p.m. Central Time U.S. And we go through daylight savings time this weekend. So it'll be an hour earlier. So we're 6 hours apart right now. It'll be only 5 hours apart, but it's still at 2 p.m. So that would be like 7 p.m. your time. I'll send you that note. And also just Google Summer of Code projects. You already have that, but why not? And then like, here's just an example API page for your own entertainment. And I also recommend this OMI-ZSH because it tells you what branch you're in, and that can be so incredibly powerful. And then,
you were telling me the other time.
Yeah, and that's just my local one, local backend. You don't need that. Here's another. This is from the risk tab, just an example of the SBOM that you can get. Oh, that's just a file because I downloaded it, so that's useless. But yeah, I'll send you those things. I'm going to hit send on those things right now. And that'll give you a collection of things to work with. And since you're in our Slack channel now, I welcome you, you know, going ahead and sending me messages as you go through the process. I'm going to post the micro tasks before Monday. I just had a very busy week and did not get through those micro tasks.
Okay, it's understandable. Okay.
Yeah, so.
I'm actually wondering. So definitely the GSOC projects will be holding in the machine learning workers, right?
Yes.
I mean,
the project you selected will use the project you select will definitely use a machine learning worker.
Okay.
And I think a lot of them will require some form of machine learning. Let me just go through Like, I think the most interesting projects are advancing risk predictions with machine learning. Expert systems, I think, are a generation behind design-wise, but you could try that one. For contributor data, let's see. So there's this contributor worker for Augur, which would be great. Okay. And then also this shared resource focused on dependencies and open source software, which also would apply to the risk working group. So you could, for certain, do this risk one. So this is more risk focused than the one at the very top. Essentially, this would be, this is risk, they're both, one is, this is like risk prediction focused from a machine learning perspective. And then this other one is risk prediction focused from understanding dependencies, risks, and vulnerabilities. So this one I would say is more likely to be a data gathering task.
Okay.
And the one at the top is more likely to be a data, that's a machine learning task. Although a proposal for machine learning here, I would be, you know, if like some of this detail, like if you say, I want to use vulnerability detection and some dependency checking. The thing is, though, I think you would end up doing more development of collection software than machine learning.
Okay.
And so at the top, there's enough data already to assess risk with machine learning. We just want to make it more complete. And so this is by far, I think, the best opportunity for a machine learning worker. An expert system is not machine learning. An expert system is essentially, it relies a lot on human input. And I did my master's work at the University of Minnesota under the group of people who created recommender systems. And they rely on a matrix of data that is both sparse and has variation in it. And what we lack in open source is sparse data. So you end up with very dense matrices for the most part. And those kinds of dense matrices are much harder to do recommender systems on. So I think from a computer science perspective, just fundamentally using recommender systems with a well-populated matrix is gonna be frustrating. There's a couple contributor ones. There's Sorting Hat, which is solid, and you know, you can certainly work with that. This looks like a build us a login. Prototyping metrics displayed on the Chaos website. This is an automation task. Automating releases is a similar task, and then automatically identifying contributor aliases. And then develop a shared data resource focus on dependencies. That's really the data collection one. Does that help?
Okay. Yeah, it helps a lot. One more thing, you know, to note, the projects, I mean, the machine learning projects, the advanced risk prediction projects. Oh, you've closed the tab?
Oh, I did. I didn't close it. Yeah, I can.
Okay. Yeah, the requirements states that one should have experience with API, email, GitHub, and graphic editor program.
Yeah, so, that's not actually very important.
Okay. Because I was thinking that, okay, maybe the machine learning part is not really that important, and they And those are actually more important than the machine learning part.
Yeah, I'll just I would say writing SQL and an interest in machine learning. Yeah, there's no front end part of that that I anticipate.
Oh, yeah. And interest, I think you mistakenly got another in.
Oh yeah, I did, yeah. I thought I was correcting myself, but I actually made it worse. And then in interest.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so I'm actually wondering about the graphic editors, the graphic editors parts.
Yeah, I'm not even sure what I mean by that. I just mean like you don't need a graphic editor either for that. That would be. All right. Any other questions, Stephen?
None for now.
All right.
So I guess I'll just try and replicate, you know, what you know, the explanations you've given me. So I'll just go through everything again.
I'll post this video and share it with you.
Oh, okay, great. That would be nice.
Yeah.
And I guess I could always reach out to you on Slack if I have any.
Yes, questions. That's one of the reasons I add folks to Slack channels. Because it's it's a really good way to communicate quickly. I'm not a really good email responder, candidly. And so getting, especially developers, getting them on Slack, it's better. You get my attention significantly faster.
That's true.
For sure.
That's true. I guess that's all my questions for now.
All right. So
if I have any new questions, I'll reach out to you.
All right. I'm gonna post the micro tasks by the end of the weekend for sure. I'm gonna try to do it right now since we have a little time left after the hackathon.
Okay, great. And another stuff is this. I don't know if it will be included in the micro task. You said that there are already existing machine learning models, you know, being implemented. Yeah. So, and the task, I mean, the project is just to upgrade.
I think you can take the task in one of several directions. One of the directions could be to create an entirely new machine learning worker. One of the directions could be to look at the results that are available in the three existing machine learning workers. And I will give you access to a database that might help you think about it.
Okay.
I'll do a database. So it'll have a bunch of machine learning data and enough data to run machine learning against so that you would kind of have an idea of what to do. And I will also see. So for example, in the case of, here's some queries I started the other day, I'll just throw in your Slack channel. These might be ways, and I haven't finished this yet, but it might give you an idea of how you might use the like the message analysis worker, in the to so this is against a database that's about open scientific software, and you know, find the busiest, most negative repos, finding issues PRs with the most discussion. There's some, you could basically see the SQL statements are in between the tick marks, right? Like that's a SQL statement. I didn't do a careful job of separating that for you, sorry.
It's all right.
What I could do is, I have all the same queries without the decoration. That you could actually copy and paste that second block that I sent you straight into a SQL browser when I send you a copy of the database.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
So I should use the second one instead.
Say that again.
I should use the second one.
There's a little bit more explanation in the first one, but you could use the second one. Okay. You literally copy and paste the entire block and it'll all just run. Okay. Whereas in the first block, I have markdown syntax in there, where the SQL statement itself is delineated and there's some headers, obviously making it more readable in an online setting. And then I just, where I ran it in my SQL editor, I just kept the current stuff, you know, this where, so I could just hit run and have all four queries run. And in the last query, the ones that I specify are those that seem to have the most recent negatively sentimented messages.
Okay.
Inside them.
Okay.
So, yeah. Anything else you want to chat about here at the end?
No, sorry, I didn't get that.
All right. Thank you very much for joining the hackathon, Stephen, and I hope to see you in the Google Summer of Code this summer. now lost amongst all of the stuff is my Zoom window, but... I turned off my video, I guess, because you were having trouble. But I'll stop the recording and say thank you. I'll turn on my video once more just to say thank you very much. Really enjoyed our discussion, and we'll talk with you soon.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.